Hello everyone, I welcome you all for the course Engineering Metrology. So the today's topic is comparators. So this is the second lecture on the topic comparators. So the contents of the today's topic are, so recalling of the first lecture, and then we will discuss the what are the uses of the comparator, and we will discuss what are the characteristics of good comparator, and then we will classify the comparators, and then we will discuss two mechanical comparators. One is a dial indicator and another one is the retype mechanical comparators, and then we will summarize the today's topic contents. So from the first lecture we understood what is a standard. A standard is the known quantity which can be used to compare the unknown quantity. So this standard is inbuilt in some of the instruments like vernier calipers and micrometer, and in some devices the standards are separated from the instrument. So it provides the it compares the unknown length with the standard. So such measurement is known as the comparison measurement. So the instrument which provides the comparison measurement is called the comparator. So the comparator works on the relative measurement. So the comparators, we have varieties of comparators, but only the difference between them is the magnification of the comparators. And then we understood what is the direct measurement and comparative measurement. So in the direct measurement, we measure the dimensions directly on the calibrated scale. So that is called the direct measurement. So in the comparison measurements, we use the standard and the deviations are measured. So that is called the comparison measurement. And also we understood what is the need of a comparator. So when we produce the components in large volume, and we need to check the many parameters on each component, so the comparator is very useful. So in that case, so we cannot use the micrometers or vernier calipers for measuring the various parameters on the each component quickly. So in that case, we use the comparators. So when we use the micrometers or vernier calipers, the technician, the operator needs skills for operating the micrometers or vernier calipers to take the measurements, and also it takes the more time for measuring the large number of parameters. So this comparator helps gives the all the measurements within a short time or less time. So that's why the comparators are very useful in mass production. So the in comparators, the difference is shown as magnified on the dial. So the magnification may be 2,000 times are quite common, and some comparators may have the magnification of 40,000 times also. So this is the today's class. The what are the uses of the comparators? Comparators are used in various ways. One is we can use the comparator as a laboratory standard. So for setting up of the inspection gauges, and also for inspecting the new purchased gauges, we use the comparators. And also we use the comparator as a working gauge. So because the components may be manufactured at different stages, at each stage we need to inspect the sizes of the components. So for inspecting the components, we use the comparator, and we can inspect, and if there is any deviation occurs in the dimensions, then we will do the rework. So before rejecting the product, so we can prevent the work spoilage, and to maintain the required tolerances, we use the comparators. And also we can use the comparator as a final inspection gauge, so where we can use selective assembly of parts. So in this, the parts are classified or graded into number of groups, so depending upon their tolerances. In order to grouping of these components so we use the comparator as a final inspection gauge, and also we use the comparator as a receiving inspection gauge for checking the parts received from outside sources or from the vendors. If any component is received, so we need to check the parts for the correct dimensions. So as a receiving inspection gauge, we use the comparators. Comparators can also be used in mass production, where the components are to be checked at a very fast rate. So we need to check the large number of dimensions or more number of dimensions on large volume of the components at a very fast rate. So for that purpose also, we use the comparators. And next, coming to the, what are the characteristics of the good comparator? The first characteristic that is required for the comparator is robust design and construction. So the design and construction of the comparator should be robust so that it can withstand the effects of the ordinary users without affecting its measuring accuracy. And the second characteristic is linear characteristics of scale. That means the recording or measuring scale should be linear and it should be uniform, and its indications should also be clear on the scale. And high magnification, third characteristic is high magnification. The magnification of the comparator should be such that even the small deviation in size of the component can also be read using the comparator. And quick in results, the indicating system should be such that the readings are obtained in the least possible time. Versatility means the instruments should be designed such that it can be used for a wide range of measurements. And a minimum wear of contact point. So here the measuring plunger is contacts with the workpiece continuously for checking the component sizes. So the wearing of the material takes place. So in order to avoid the wearing, the plunger material is selected such that it should have minimum wear of contact point. Generally, the hardened steel materials or diamond materials are used to minimize the wear effects. So further, the contact pressure should be low and uniform. And another characteristic is free from oscillations. So the pointer should come rapidly, so to the rest, and it should be free from the oscillations and free from backlash. So as we are using the gears or levers or pinion and rack and pinion arrangements for magnifying the systems, if there is any clearance between the two gears, so that produce the backlash error. So what happens is it lost its motion. So and right, it should be free from the friction. And there is a quick insertion of the workpiece. That means it should be provided for lifting the plunger for a quick insertion of the workpiece. And adjustable table. The table of the instrument should preferably be adjustable in a vertical sense. Compensation from temperature effects. The indicator should be provided with the maximum compensation for temperature effects. The comparator can be used at elevated temperatures and also used at the room temperatures So the measuring accuracy should not affect the temperature. And the last characteristic is means to prevent damage. So even if the plunger moves through a greater distance than the corresponding range of its measuring scale, the comparator should not be damaged. So it should prevent from the damage. Next, coming to the classification of the comparators. So comparators are classified into mechanical comparators. So these are maybe dial indicators, reed type mechanical comparators, Johansson microcator, Sigma comparator. And the second one is the electrical and electronics comparators, electromechanical comparators, optical comparators, mechanical optical comparators. In that we have the optical lever, GES optimizer, GES ultra optimeter, GES opto test comparator. And we have the pneumatic comparators, and then we have the fluid displacement comparators, and then we have the multi-check comparators. So in that we have the electric multi-check comparator, air multi-check comparator, combination of air and electric comparator. And there is the automatic gauging machines we have, and then we have the projection comparators, and then we have the high sensitive calibration comparators. So in that we discuss the Brooks level comparator, Edenrode Millionth comparator. The first one is the mechanical comparator. So as we know, comparator is a precision instrument used to measure the dimensions of a given workpiece with the actual working standard. So mechanical comparators are the type of comparator which is made up of mechanical means. Mechanical means it uses the levers, it uses the gears, it uses the rack and pinion. So such kind of means are used to magnify the movement of the plunger to improve the accuracy of the instrument. So in this, so what is meant by magnification? So magnification is nothing but multiplying the small movement of the plunger or spindle or stylus, and that converts the movement into a large scale consisting of number of divisions. So that is called the magnification. So the mechanical comparators are four types. One is a dial indicator, another one is the reed type mechanical comparator, Johansson microcator, and Sigma comparator. So let us see in the today's class about the dial indicator and the reed type mechanical comparator. The dial indicator is used to measure the small measurements accurately. So when the dial indicator is used in measuring any measuring equipment for comparison purpose, then it is called the dial gauge. So when the dial indicator can be called as a dial gauge, when the dial indicator is used in any measuring equipment for comparison purpose. A dial indicator must be mounted on any other base or equipment, otherwise it will be useless. The accuracy of the dial indicator can be up to 0.001 mm. So there is a classification of dial indicators based on their dial shape. They are sector shape dial indicators and circular shape dial indicators. So sector shape dial indicators have the limited range. So this type of sector indicators are used for extremely accurate measurements. So there are two types of dial indicators. One is the gear and pinion type mechanical indicator, gear and pinion type dial indicator, and a lever type dial indicator. So let us see the circular type dial indicator. So this dial indicator consists of the following parts. One is the dial with a main scale. This is the dial with the main scale, and this is the indicator. This is the indicator or pointer. The next consists of the plunger. This is the plunger. And mini dial. This is the small dial. That is called the mini dial. That is also called revolution counter to represent the number of revolutions of the indicator. And there is a locking screw, so which can locks the pointer. magnification mechanism. So we may use either lever mechanism or gear and pinion mechanism. There is a stem. So this is called the stem of the dial indicator. And there is a bezel. So this is the bezel. So which can be rotated on the main scale. So this can be clamped at any desired position. So this can be used to set the so if you rotate the bezel, the scale, the main scale also rotate, or the main scale also rotate. So and you can set the comparator to zero position by rotating the bezel. So in the dial indicators, we have the contact point. So the contact points are different types. One is the standard or spherical contact point. So this is the most preferred one because it presents the point contact to the measuring surface or mating surface. So irrespective of it may be flat workpiece or a cylindrical workpiece. So this spherical contact presents the point contact with the mating surface. So this is the standard point or spherical contact point. And this is the tapered point. This point is convenient for component surfaces that cannot be accessed either by standard or flat contact points. Sometimes we need to measure the deviations on this type of components. So in this case, the standard or spherical contact cannot be used to check these dimensions. So in this case, the tapered point contact points are used for measuring the deviations. And there is a button type contact point. So this is used if the light contact pressure is required on smaller components. So we use the button type contact points. And there is a flat point is also available. So these flat points are used when there is a concave shaped surfaces or spherical surfaces want to inspect. So we use the flat point. So flat point presents the are more suitable for inspecting the spherical surfaces. Paradoxically, the flat contact points are not preferred for flat surfaces. On the other hand, the presence of thin air film can lead to the minor errors. On the other hand, the higher the area of contact with the component may result in rapid wear and tear of the contact point. So this is the working principle of the dial indicator. So as we already discussed in the linear measuring instruments. So and also we'll discuss in this lecture also. So this dial indicator, this is the mechanism provided in the dial indicator. So this consists of the plunger. This consists of the plunger. And this plunger is supported or moves through the rack guide. The plunger moves through the rack guide. And there is a coil spring. And there are some gears and pinions. So on the plunger, there is a rack is cut. On the plunger, there is a rack is cut. So this rack meshes with the pinion P1. And the gear G1 is also mounted on the same pinion shaft. And this gear G is again connected to the gear G2 or pinion P2. And on the same shaft, there is another gear G2 is also mounted. So this gear 2 is connected to the pinion P3. This pinion P3 is connected to the gear G3. So this system is used to magnify the small movement of the plunger into a large movement of the pointer on the calibrated scale. So here there is a rack guide, so which can allows the plunger to move only in this direction, either upward or downward through this rack guide. So this prevents the rotation of the plunger about its own axis. And there is a coil spring, so which helps to apply a small pressure on the plunger. Otherwise, instead of leaving the application of the pressure on the plunger to the operator or instructor, so this mechanism is provided to apply a small gauging pressure on the instrument. So this coil spring also helps to reset the comparator after each measurement. So the operation of the dial comparator, we will explain. So this is the plunger. So we place the workpiece underneath the plunger. So if any small movement given to the plunger by the workpiece, so this plunger will move upside, upwards, and then the rack pushes the pinion P1. So the rack and the pinion and the gear is mounted on, G1 is mounted on the same shaft. The gear G1 also gets the same motion. So this is connected to the pinion P2. So we will, and also the gear G2 on the same shaft, the motion is transferred to gear G2. And then from the gear G2, the motion is transferred to pinion P3. From the pinion P3, the motion is transferred to the gear G3. So on the gear G3 and the pointer mount on the same spindle. So the pointer will deflect on the calibrated scale. And there is a hair spring, so which can be used to provide the backlash error, and also used to control the movement of the plunger to regain its original position. This is how the working of the gear and pinion type mechanism and dial indicator. So here we will magnify the input of the plunger in two stages. One is between this gear G2 and pinion P3, and this gear G1 and pinion. Gear and the this pinion and pinion and the gear G2, pinion and the gear G2, and pinion P2 and the So we'll obtain the magnification in two stages. One is from the gear G1 to pinion P2. And then from gear G2 to pinion P3. So in two stages, we can obtain the magnification. So this is the backside view of the dial indicator. So we have the number of gears, and there is a guide, rack guide. So the the plunger will move in the rack only. So which allows the movement of the plunger only upward and downward. And there is no rotation of the plunger about its own axis. And there is a coil spring so which helps to apply some gauging pressure. And there is some gears are mounted. So finally, the dial is mounted on this gear. So that shows the variation of the measurement on the calibrated scale. So this is also shows the mechanism of the dial indicator. Next, we'll discuss the working principle of lever mechanism in dial indicator. So we have the lever type dial indicators, and we have the gear and pinion type of dial indicator mechanisms. So this is the lever type mechanism in dial indicator. In generally, most dial indicators uses the lever type mechanism. The principle of lever mechanism of dial indicator is very quite simple. The plunger and the indicator are connected by the levers shown in the figure. So AC is the lever. This lever is pivoted at point B. So the total magnification of this simple lever mechanism is BC by AB. So BC by AB is the magnification of the simple lever mechanism. Similarly, there is a compound lever mechanism. There are multiple levers are connected. So here AC is one lever, and let us CE is the another lever. So these two are connected by fork joint. So the in this compound lever mechanism, the accuracy is less, and range of the measurement is also low. So in this compound lever mechanism, the total magnification is achieved as, so DE by CD multiplied by BC by AB. So we'll get the magnification in two stages. Here one stage, let us one stage, and this is the another stage. Next, coming to the, what are the uses of the dial indicator? So the dial indicator is used for, one is determining the error in geometrical forms. Say you can check the taper error, roundness error, ovality error. And also we can use for determining the errors in surfaces like alignment errors, parallelism, squareness errors, etc. And also we can use the dial indicator for comparison of two heights or distance within small limits. We can also use the comparator for measuring the compression and also tension in testing of the materials. So practically in machine tools application, we use the dial indicator to check the trueness of the milling machine or burrs, and also to check the parallelism of shaper machine ram with the surface, to check the alignment of lathe machine centers by using a bar between the centers. So these are the various applications. This is very important in the gate point of view also applications. Next, coming to the reed type mechanical comparator. So what is mean by reed in reed type mechanical comparator? So reed is a long supporting rod or shaft. So in reed type comparators, we use the number of reeds to avoid the frictional contacts. So here we have the four reeds. So this is one reed and this is the another reed. Two vertical reeds we have. We have the two vertical reeds. So one is connected, we have the two vertical reeds, and we have the two blocks A and B, and we have the pointer. So these are the elements of the mechanical comparator. So we have the four reeds and two blocks, and there is a plunger or spindle, and there is a pointer. Out of four reeds, two reeds are placed vertically, and one is connected to the block A, which is fixed. Another vertical reed, which is connected to the block B, which is floating. And there are another two reeds are horizontally placed, which connects the block A and block B. as the plunger moves upside, so if the component is to be inspected, component is placed underneath the spindle or plunger. So any linear movement of the spindle causes the floating block to move upwards or upside. And the vertical read on the right side of the block B will move upside, and the pointer starts deflects on the calibrated scale. So in this way, the mechanical read type mechanical comparator works. So this is the mechanism of the read type mechanical comparator. So here the working standard will be placed underneath of the comparator or plunger to take the dimension as the required dimension. So this could be taken using the slip gauges. So working standard as the slip gauge, and take the readings and remove the actual working standard. Now place the workpiece underneath the plunger to take the measurement of the workpiece and compare the reading with the actual working standard reading. So the mechanical magnification usually less than 100, but it is multiplied by the optical lens system. So it is available amplification ranging from 500 to 1000 times of the movement of the plunger. So this is about the today's class. So in the today's class, we discussed the what are the uses of the comparators. So we can use the comparator as a laboratory standard for setting the inspection gauges and for inspection of newly purchased gauges. And we can also use the comparator as a working gauge in order to inspect the component at different stages of manufacturing to prevent the work spoilage and to minimize the rejection rate. And also we can use the comparator as a final inspection gauge in the selective assembly of the parts. So where the parts are classified depending upon the tolerances into number of groups. So this final comparator will be useful as a final inspection gauge. And also we can use the as a receiving inspection gauge for checking the parts received from the outside sources or vendors. And comparators can be used in mass production where the components are to be checked at a very fast rate. And we discussed what are the characteristics of the comparators. First characteristic is robust design and construction, and linear characteristics of the scale, and high magnification, quick end results, versatility, minimum wear of contact point, free from oscillations, backlash, error should be minimum, and a quick insertion of the workpiece is possible, and adjustable table is in vertical sense is possible, and a compensation from the temperature effects, and means to prevent damage. And then we discussed the classification of the comparators. We have the mechanical comparators, electrical and electronics comparators, electromechanical comparators, optical comparators, pneumatic comparators, mechanical and optical comparators, fluid displacement comparators, multi-check comparators, automatic gauging machines, projection comparators, high sensitive calibration comparators. So mechanical comparators are the type of comparator which is made up of mechanical means. That means it uses the levers, gears, rack and pinion for magnifying the small movement of the plunger into a large scale of the large movement of the pointer on the calibrated scale. So in the read type of mechanical comparator, we use the number of reads to avoid the frictional contacts. So these are the references followed for preparing the material. Thank you.